people like me, female, Jewish, immigrant, refugee, weren't exactly being appointed to the bench in droves. So really all I was aspiring to do when I graduated from law school with five other women was to be a really good lawyer.
In her final day on the bench, after 17 years, she had the Supreme Court in tears, and she said some herself. It was, as ever, that distinct mix of a brilliant legal mind which has transformed the country, and her unbounded heart, her idealism, and her humanity, qualities that have marked the extraordinary life of Justice Rosalie Silberman Abella, or simply Rosie to her friends. Jewish, female, immigrant, refugee, that's how she describes herself. The daughter of Holocaust survivors. Her parents' first son and Justice Abella's brother was killed by the Nazis. She was born in a displaced persons camp in Germany. Her family came to Canada. Her father, a trained lawyer, not allowed to practice here. And she vowed she would. By the age of 29, she was a judge and pregnant. She'd already, by 1984, made a mark that resonates today. She was appointed as the commissioner of the Royal Commission of Equality in Employment. She literally invented the term employment equity and changed the country's understanding of equality for women, people with disabilities, indigenous peoples, visible minorities for generations. And now, after 17 years on the Supreme Court bench, some still regard that work as her most lasting. But she's recognized in other ways. She, of course, famously moderated that federal leaders debate.
Live from Ottawa, Encounter 88.
Good evening.
And her work is recognized around the world. In the U.S., she's often compared to Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg, and RBG called Justice Abella, quote, among her dearest sisters-in-law as she leaves the Supreme Court. What concerns her about the future? What role should the courts play in society? Are they too active, as some say? Let's find out. It is a privilege and a pleasure to welcome Justice Abella to her first interview, I think, in decades. Thank you so much. Welcome to the program.
Thank you. You picked a very emotional day for me to be making my television debut again, and I can't think of a better place to just kind of share what an incredible voyage it's been. So thank you for asking me.
Justice Abella, in your last speech on the bench, you said, people like me don't become judges, female, Jewish, immigrant, refugees. You say immigrants live for opportunities, not entitlement. So on your last day on the court, who did you think of most as you sat there?
Oh, I thought of my family. I thought of the people I went on this journey with. I thought of my parents, who encouraged me to be whatever I wanted to be. I thought of my husband, who was married to the only woman he knew among all of her friends, who was both a mother and in the paid labor force at the same time, who loved me. So that was, it was a day to think about origins. Because when you come to endings, you start to give yourself permission to think about the arc and where it began.
One of the things that has marked your career in the law is your unapologetic mixing of your biography and your life and how it's informed your work as a judge, your how you see the law. How has your biography informed your legal career?
I think we're all shaped by what we've come from. Some people embrace what they've come from. Some people spend a fair bit of energy trying to distance themselves. I never felt anything but a seamless relationship with who I was, my religion, my gender, my origins, the Holocaust that my parents had survived. So I'm unabashedly committed to the values that increase justice for people. I'm not at all embarrassed about the fact that I am shaped by who I am. But I have learned as a judge that you take who you are, you take your own experiences, but when you are in a courtroom, you have to understand that what you are listening to may have nothing to do with any of that. Learning to be a judge means learning to put your own views aside and actually listening. know, keeping your mind open, listening to the arguments. Judging isn't about me. It's not a top-down exercise. It's looking at the world through the eyes of the people who are before us, whom we're judging, to right. see what that world looks like, and then apply to the law to it in as fair a way as you can.
I mentioned in the your work in 1984 on employment equity and how you pioneered that. You've told me that you think that might be your greatest accomplishment. Tell me why, the impact of that, because here we are all these decades later in the Me Too moment, in the Black Lives Matter moment, many issues of equity, many issues of inclusion, many issues of inequity and privilege that we talk about as if they're just emerging, but you were dealing with that in your report. Tell me why that work is so important to you and why it still resonates today, or did it? Is the work just so important? Is it still ongoing?
I mean, the whole notion of inclusion, of keeping our focus on who is excluded and making sure that we include more, is really what has made Canada's multiculturalism such a worldwide success. Because in that report, and the reason I feel it's kind of stayed, it was a chance to think about what equality means for Canada. There had not at the time been any decisions on the Supreme Court yet about what Section 15, the equality section, meant. So I traveled across the country to 17 cities in six right. weeks. I was able to build on a set of diverse experiences that made where I've ended up a much more enriching responsibility for me. So it wasn't just law that I'd learned along the way. I'd learned about policy. I learned about people. I learned about life. And I always stayed open to the possibility that what I knew
right.
wasn't the end of the story.
In 2017, you were given a degree at Brandeis University, and you said, quote, "I'm deeply worried about the state of justice in the world." You said, "Here we are, seven decades after the Second World War and the Holocaust. We're watching never again turn into again and again." You said, "We're watching the wonderful democratic consensus fragment, shattered by narcissistic populism, an unhealthy tolerance for intolerance, a cavalier indifference to equality, a deliberate amnesia about the instruments and values of democracy that are no less crucial than elections, and a shocking disrespect for the borders between power and its independent adjudicators like the press and the courts." It was a powerful indictment. What worries you today?
Same thing. The same thing. The way that consensus that emerged out of the rubble of World War II, the human and physical devastation, and the commitments we made then, not only to democratic institutions, but to the rights that people had, so that no longer would any of them have to fear the demonization and the genocide and the rights abuses that the world tolerated. That was a commitment that I believed in, and my generation grew up thinking that everybody had signed on, and that's the way the world was going to continue to be. And then it didn't, and it wasn't, and it hasn't. And it is terrifying to me, because I think if there is a failure of rights somewhere, there is a failure of rights potentially everywhere. And the greater our tolerance becomes for abuses that we shouldn't for a second tolerate, the less we become the world that I was born into in 1946. And it terrifies me that there's no concern about, we wag our fingers at the countries who do bad things. We sign letters, we rebuke them publicly, but nothing ever happens. We've lost the ability as a global community, it seems, to figure out how to develop moral standards that are enforceable. And that really worries me, because over the years, I'm sure you've seen it too, it's not getting any better. I mean, there may be interstitial and incremental progress, but then it goes back, and we demonized the words of democracy. We've replaced majority minority relationships and the balancing with populism, with authoritarianism, with crushing the media, crushing the independence of the judiciary, crushing the independence of the bar and the rights of minorities. And we read about it all the time, and we worry about it all the time, and nothing happens.
Some people say the courts are too active. What does Justice Abella say? Well, we continue our exclusive conversation with Justice Abella. Welcome back to the program. Look, you know there's a lot of questions right now about the role of judges in the world. Some of your critics have said you've been guilty of judicial activism and overreach. In your last statement on the bench, you said, quote, after the charter, judges could no longer be defenders of the status quo. Justice was an application of law to life, not an application of laws to facts. What do you mean by that? And what do you tell people who say this is judicial activism?
There was no such concept as judicial activism when the charter first came in. It was amazing to see. Judges used to interpret statutes. Constitutional law was about whether something was federal or provincial jurisdiction, egg marketing boards, not everyone's favorite subject in law school. Then we got the charter, and the country reacted so positively to Bertha Wilson and Brian Dixon muscularly interpreting this brand new assignment by the legislature to the judges to protect rights, which were now constitutional. That was all through the 80s, as the court struck down abortion laws, as the court weighed in on criminal law rights, human rights. And then the 90s came and the culture changed, and we started to get the supply side rhetoric from the United States, which said, presumptively, do not take as credible decisions of judges which expand rights. And that turned out to be, if you kind of detangled it, we don't like this result. So we're going to call it something that will make the public consider it to be beyond judicial role, judicial trespass. The truth is, of course, judges are active. When you interpret a law, which is what we do, you are making law. When we interpreted, when Lord Sankey in England interpreted the word persons to include women in 1929, he was interpreting a word. He made law. Women became eligible for the Senate. So we got into all of these pillow fights about should they make law, and we ignored the whole history of common law. Judges have always made law. But what these were not genuine reflections of what judges do and should do. They were genuine reflections of a particular view of law as being something that should be restricted and not subject to expansion by judges. So you never heard the word judicial activism applied when a judge restricted rights.
I want to talk to you about what is your message to people that say the courts are, because of the charter, they're taking too prominent a role, that they're infringing on what elected officials should do, that the court should just be a little more stick to their lane, their originalism, and that the living tree is growing out of control.
So we never didn't stick to our lane. This is our lane. We interpret statutes, we interpret laws and policies, and we interpret constitutions, and the Constitution since 1982 included the protection of rights, human rights, and civil liberties. Parliament gave it to us. And if you're going to get an assignment from Parliament and a constitutionalized set of rights, you have to interpret and enforce them. And sometimes that means you're going to be upsetting a lot of people who think you should have decided the other way. And that's why judges have tenure. So that they can protect their impartiality, cannot be removed from office until they're 75 for decisions they make that are unpopular, because that's not our role. We're not there to be popular.
Right.
We are there to do the right thing on the public interest behalf, not on behalf of one side or the other. And there is no court case, by the way, where the person who doesn't win ever feels the court got it right.
Right.
So,
okay.
That's our lane. That's what we do.
You know, if you look at cases, and you don't have to comment specifically on the case, but the Meng Wanzhou case, and Canada says, we're following the rule of law, but China says, we're following the rule of law in China too. Everybody's following the so-called rule of law. You've written about this. What bothers you about the expression rule of law?
Well, I'm not going to comment at all about the particular case at all. But what worries me about the rule of law is that it's one of those malleable terms that that I'm comfortable with when people who have a view of democracy I share use. But I also find that it is sometimes used by people who are defending the law of rules without the texture of the rule of law. So I, for me, have always thought you're really talking about the rule of justice. Or a just rule of law, because it isn't just law. Law gave us segregation, it gave us apartheid, it gave us genocidal discrimination in the Third Reich. So I don't have the same affection for the term, because I don't think it really tells the public what it is we're doing. And I'm getting the same nervousness about the word democracy. Democracy to me had always meant the relationship between the state, the court, rights, the press, minority. It was a balancing. It has come to mean what does the majority want?
Right.
And that's a threat to the perception of the courts, because courts don't always do what the majority wants. We are the institution with the independence sometimes to defend and protect and promote the rights of minorities who don't reflect what the majority wants.
I want to tell you on behalf of many people, and I've gotten to know you over many, many years. It's been one of the great privileges of my life. Your work is extraordinary. I wish you luck in your next chapter at Harvard and the many things that we're going to watch you doing. Your accomplishments continue to resonate, and it is just an honor to have you on this program and to listen to your humanity and your optimism and your brilliance. Thank you, Justice Abella. It's a real honor to have you on the program.
Thank you, Evan. It's an honor to be here.
All right, that is Justice Rosalie Abella. Of course, she'll have 6 more months working on cases already, but she will no longer be sitting on the bench.